Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Iwigara, American Indian Ethnobotanical Traditions and Science, by Enrique Salmón, narrated by Kaipo Schwab. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you may hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Happily abundant passing showers I desire. Happily an abundance of vegetation I desire. Happily an abundance of pollen I desire. Happily abundant dew I desire. Happily may fair white corn to the ends of the earth come with you. Happily may fair yellow corn to the ends of the earth come with you. Happily may fair blue corn to the ends of the earth come with you. Happily may fair corn of all kinds to the ends of the earth come with you. Happily may fair plants of all kinds to the ends of the earth come with you. Navajo Diné Night Chant. Introduction. I was raised by a mother, a grandmother, and other extended family members who were living libraries of indigenous plant knowledge that has been collected, revised, and tested for millennia. This kind of knowledge is not housed in a building, stored on shelves according to some fixed system. It lives in the memories, oral literature, and daily rituals of its practitioners. As I grew up, I was exposed to this plant knowledge during regular plant collecting excursions. And it was reinforced each time we cooked a traditional meal, every time my mother or grandmother treated me for an ailment, whenever I helped my grandfather in our cornfield. I took this early exposure to plant knowledge for granted, not knowing that it was becoming a rarity among most young people in our modern society. Even as I was learning the practicalities of collecting, preparing, and administering plants, I was being exposed to a worldview that perceives plants as relatives. I was raised to respect all things, especially plants, as living beings. Now, as a native ethnobotanical scholar, I have struggled with how to translate this worldview into terms that can be understood by non-Indigenous people. I am often asked, "What is ethnobotany?" My usual answer is to quote Richard I. Ford. He was one of my mentors, and he defined ethnobotany thus: the study of direct interrelationships between people and plants. Normally, that response elicits blank looks. Perhaps it is better to tell how I followed my path into this field. During my university years, whenever I was given the opportunity to choose a topic for a research paper, I invariably wrote about American Indians and plants. My master's degree thesis focused on medical plant knowledge and shamanism among three native cultures of the Southwest. It was at this point that my graduate advisor informed me that I was clearly on track to becoming an ethnobotanist. Ever since that conversation, I, like hundreds of ethnobotanists around the world, have devoted my life to studying how all people, not just indigenous peoples, interact with the plants in their local environments. It is painstaking and rewarding work that requires years of observing and participating with people in their local environments as they talk about plants, as they gather and use plants, as they make decisions about where to harvest plants, and as they sometimes battle with local authorities in order to protect plant gathering areas and access to plants. I have participated in applied ethnobotanical work in Ethiopia, Australia, and North America, from Alaska to Mexico. I go, gladly, wherever native peoples are demanding their rights to sustainably manage their landscapes, as their ancestors have done for thousands of years. In other words, ethnobotanists have become advocates for environmental justice, applied conservationism, and indigenous rights. In 2000, I wrote an article for Ecological Applications, Kin-Centric Ecology, Indigenous Perceptions of the Human-Nature Relationship, In it, I drew upon ideas and concepts from my own tribal worldview of our relationship with and responsibility to place, in an effort to explain how American Indians see themselves as part of an extended ecological family. I focused on the Rarámuri concept of iwigara, writing, "Iwigara channels the idea that all life, spiritual and physical, is interconnected in a continual cycle, and expresses the belief that all life shares the same breath. We are all related to and play a role in the complexity of life. In a worldview based on iwigara, humans are no more important to the natural world than any other form of life. This notion influences how I lead my own life and guides many of my decisions. Knowing that I am related to everything around me and share breath with all living things helps me to focus on my responsibility to honor all forms of life. I carefully consider all living and non-living things when making choices or weighing actions I might take. In short, I see myself as one of many stewards of the land and natural world. I share breath with it, so I endeavor to minister to it with appropriate ritual, thought, and ceremony. Before writing this book, I conferred with native plant practitioners, my professional ethnobotanical network, and with close friends. I asked these knowledge holders and wisdom keepers to help me compile a list of plants that are the most culturally relevant to North American native peoples. Instead of trying to create a comprehensive list of every plant known to be used by one populace or another and all their potential uses, my goal was to focus on the plants that, overall, hold the most significance for indigenous peoples of the contiguous United States and Canada. In other words, what plants are the most important in the minds of native North American peoples? The answer is the following volume, consisting of 80 plant entries. Ethnobotany is an area of study that interests both academics and lay people. Unfortunately, most ethnobotanical texts are written by and for academics. The layperson, even one who is keenly interested in ethnobotanical knowledge, may not wish to decipher the esoteric jargon and not-so-engaging writing styles of professional ethnobotanists. Numerous books and other sources of information about American Indian plant knowledge focus on the same plants over and over, or read more like medicinal plant dictionaries. I tried to do something different here, to present a selection of American Indian ethnobotanical knowledge that is scientific in scope, but written in an accessible style, and, most important of all, to blend basic scientific and medicinal information with culturally specific knowledge and culturally relevant applications. I note, therefore, how some food plants, more than merely being sources of calories, play important cultural and ceremonial roles. For example, that wapato is not only an edible tuber, but also a currency in gambling games, or that an elderberry's branches make good stems for smoking pipes. Although most of this knowledge is centuries old, I have, as much as possible, augmented it with updated contemporary information. American Indian knowledge is most often transmitted through story. Story is the fabric of our humanity. Story structures our cultures. Story affirms and activates our identities. Each person wakes up to and lives their individual, cultural, and national story every day. I also include stories, myths, and narratives about plants that provide an avenue for one to learn more than their names, wildcrafting information, and uses. It is my hope that as the information related in this book is transmitted through story, one will be introduced to the spirit and character of these featured plants. All native knowledge is local. The 80 plant entries in this book reflect knowledge from native tribes across North America. Throughout the book, I apply various modern identifiers to geographically and socially recognized regions of our continent. It should go without saying, however, that plants do not recognize abstract geopolitical boundaries. Many of the plants herein can be found outside of the areas specified in their entry. In addition, as a result of trade and periodic movements, native peoples were often familiar with plants that grew outside of their cultural boundaries. Sometimes knowledge of plants was transmitted in gender-specific channels, or a clan claimed ownership of certain plants. Some plants were reserved for use by the recognized healers or medicine people in a community. In my American Indian Studies classes, and whenever I am speaking to anyone who seems interested, I remind people that American Indian traditional knowledge is tied to the landscapes they called home. I often joke that it would be difficult to be a traditional Apache in Vermont. The landscape is too different. What's more, American Indians were never a homogeneous culture. Over 500 languages were spoken in North America prior to European contact. Each one of those languages represented a distinct culture. Each of those cultures developed a lifestyle and library of ecological knowledge that fit the ecosystems and landscapes that they had sustainably managed and lived with for centuries. Although the ethnobotanical knowledge expressed in this book will sometimes overlap and be similar among indigenous cultures, in many instances, the uses of plants will be representative of a specific culture's adaptation to an ecosystem and geographical region. Here I will give impressionistic sketches of these geographic and cultural regions as they might be perceived by the people indigenous to them. Northeast. Native peoples from the Northeast tell this origin story. A long time ago, when the earth was only water, a certain young woman lived in the sky world, a sort of island of clouds floating high above the wet world below. She lived happily and comfortably with many other sky people up there among the clouds. This particular woman discovered that she was pregnant with twins. For some reason, this news angered her husband, who flew into a rage. During his tantrum, he approached a tree that grew tall in the sky world and tore it up by its roots. This created a hole in the ground of the sky world. The pregnant woman looked down into the hole and marveled at the water covering earth below. While she was peering through the hole, her husband pushed her. She plummeted down toward the waters. It so happens that many water animals already existed on this wet earth. Luckily for the falling woman, two geese saw her tumbling from the sky. They flew toward the woman and managed to break her fall, capturing her on their soft wings. The geese gently deposited the woman onto the back of a big floating turtle, and from her perch there, the woman was introduced to other water animals, such as beaver, muskrat, swan, and osprey. The woman was grateful for her rescue, but soon began to worry. How was she going to raise her twins on the back of a turtle? The animals met and decided that, in order to create an island for the woman to live on, mud was going to have to be brought up from underneath the waters. Beaver tried to swim down to gather mud, but it was too deep, and he soon ran out of air. Muskrat tried but ran into the same problem. It was just too deep. Other animals tried without success. Finally, little toad dove into the water. He was gone for a long time, and the other animals became concerned. Then all of a sudden, Toad floated to the surface. The animals thought he was dead, but when they looked more closely, they could see that not only was Toad still alive, but he had a mouth full of mud. The animals took the mud and spread it over the back of Turtle. The mud began to dry. As it dried, it spread, and continued to spread until it formed what is now the ancestral lands of American Indians. The woman moved about this turtle island, waiting for her twins to be born. While she waited, she took dust from the new land and tossed it into the sky, creating the stars, the moon, and the sun. Eventually, her twins were born. One she named Flint, and the other Sapling. Flint, an evil twin of sorts, was responsible for bony fish, thorny bushes, and other bad things. Sapling was responsible for creating the rivers that teemed with fish, songbirds, edible and medicinal plants, all the things we love about our land. The Northeast from the Canadian Maritimes, south to where the Delaware River spills into the Chesapeake Bay, and east to the shores of Lake Erie, is a wonderfully lush region of mixed deciduous and conifer forests. The thick woods are interspersed with numerous creeks and rivers and open meadows that support a variety of useful grasses. Herbaceous plants occupy those places where meadows meet the shade of maples, birches, ash, red and white oak, white cedar, black walnut, and so many others. The forest understory includes myriad shrubs, more herbs, berries, fungi, and tubers. For centuries, native communities thrived in this landscape. They hunted the forests, fished the rivers, practiced small-scale agriculture, and gathered the bounty of their homelands. Many of the native communities of this region are Algonquin speakers. This family of languages is spoken by 29 tribal nations, including the Ojibwe, Abenaki, Potawatomi, Narragansett, Mohican, Cree, and Mi'kmaq. Other peoples of this region, such as the Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Susquehannock, Mohawk, Oneida, and Huron, are Iroquoian speakers. All these peoples shared a version of the story just related regarding how the world began. There were other origin stories as well, but all tell how the animals emerged and how the first people found their way to Turtle's back. No matter the version, these cultural histories are encoded with biocultural and ecological lessons that are woven into the daily fabric of indigenous activities. Included in many of the stories are the plants and trees of the Northeast landscape. Southeast. Before they were forcibly removed from their homeland, the Cherokee were people of the Southeast, a diverse landscape shaped by hills, mountains, savannas, marshes, and coastal scrublands. They shared this region with the Chickasaw, Creek, Seminole, Choctaw, Powhatan, and too many other tribes to name here. Like the Northeast, theirs was a land of abundance, a place where useful herbaceous plants kept company with pine, red maple, beech, ash, and walnut trees. The Cherokee knew that it was not always like this. In fact, they were latecomers to their lands. Their origin myth tells of how, in a distant past, the world was divided into three levels: the sky world, which is the upper level, the water world, which is the lower level, and the middle world, which is the earth. The animals occupied the sky world. They were curious about what lay below, so they sent little water beetle down to investigate. Water beetle darted this way and that, but could find nothing of significance. Finally, water beetle dove deep until it reached the bottom of the water. It pulled some mud back up to the surface, where it began to dry and spread out, creating an island. So that it wouldn't float away, the island was attached to the upper level, where the animals dwelled, with four cords. The island remained wet and soft for a long time. Finally, Buzzard flew down around the island to investigate. Buzzard flew low, and everywhere its wings touched the soft land, a valley or mountain was created, forming the land of the Southeast as we know it. The animals invited corn and other plants useful as food and or medicine to occupy this new land. A human brother and sister followed the plants and began to multiply. Like so many native peoples' origin myths, agriculture plays a central role in this one. To native peoples, agriculture endeavors involve much more than knowing when to plow, how to irrigate, and at what depth to sow seed. The responsibility of growing food for one's community is connected to one's identity as a member of the community. This identity, this sense of beingness, is tied to the history of the people on a landscape. Great Plains. The Great Plains is buffalo country, or at least it used to be. Before the newly minted French and British colonists began to surge west, the Great Plains were shaped largely by the movement of sharp-hoofed buffalo that tilled the soil and encouraged a distinct ecosystem, seed by seed, on their shaggy coats and through their piles of dung. Over 50 different varieties of grasses once graced the plains. There were edible panic and tripsicum grasses, fescue, long-lived and iconic buffalo grasses, and the tall and flowing blue stem. The grasslands were broken up by swaths of willows, Osage orange, hackberry, and cottonwoods. To the north were the sacred Black Hills, covered with tall cedars and spruces that, in the minds of many native peoples, acted as protectors of their lands. According to the Lakota, the presence of these guardian conifers is not the only reason the Black Hills are sacred. It is there where the people emerged. A water monster had fought a battle with the people. The monster won and proceeded to flood the world. Everywhere there was water, except for a high hill where a lone girl survived. She was visited by a spotted bald eagle, whom she later married. The marriage produced two children, a boy and a girl. All this occurred in the Black Hills, and all Lakota people are descendants of these children. After the waters receded, what was left were the flattened plains and rolling hills of the Great Plains. Many people of the plains, the Lakota, Cheyenne, Blackfoot, Kiowa, Comanche, Pawnee, and so many others, were nomadic. Others, such as the Omaha, Osage, Mandan, and Wichita, stayed in one place or were semi-nomadic. They traded their corn and other foods with those who chose to follow the herds. The nomadic peoples roamed large territories on horseback, becoming familiar not only with the movements and characteristics of the buffalo, antelope, elk, and other animals, but also with the growth patterns of the plants that composed the luxurious grasslands. In the eyes of many early American explorers, the nomadic lifestyle of Plains Indian cultures epitomized individuality, freedom, courage, and nobility. Coming to terms. Each plant entry includes suggestions on how to process the parts of the plant for use as food and or medicine. Here are the terms that are used most often throughout the book. Decoction, plant material boiled down into a thick broth, syrup, or paste. Infusion, a solution made by soaking one or more parts of a plant in water over a period of time. The resulting liquid is then taken orally. Poultice, a thick paste made from one or more parts of a plant soaked in water. The resulting soft, damp mass of material is then applied externally in a thick layer to an injured part of the body, normally to treat soreness or inflammation. Wash, a single herb or blend of herbs infused or steeped in water. The resulting wash is then used externally on the affected body part, which is submersed or soaked directly in the wash solution. Mountain West. To the west of the Great Plains were the Rocky Mountains. The caretakers of the elevations and valleys of the Rockies and the Intermountain West were the Ute, Arapaho, Crow, Flathead, Shoshone, Jicarilla Apache, and Nez Perce. They indeed perceived themselves as caretakers. Their origin stories include morals that suggest they were chosen to occupy their mountainous environments in order to protect them. The Southern Ute believed that Curious Coyote was given a bag by Creator. Coyote was supposed to carry the bag, with its unknown contents, over into the mountains and leave it there. Coyote, ever sneaky and curious, traveled the distance and stopped to peek into the bag. As soon as he opened it, little creatures began to swarm out of the bag. They were people. Coyote managed to close the bag before all of the people could escape. The ones that got out of the bag ran away in all four directions. Coyote reached the mountains where Creator told him to leave the bag. When he opened the bag, there were only a few people left inside. They were the people who became the dwellers and caretakers of the mountainous lands. The people of the mountains were few in number, but developed lifestyles that took advantage of what was offered by the seasons as well as by the different elevations. They knew how to use the different kinds of aspen, pinyon, cedar, and dogwood for medicine, food, and for building shelter. They often stayed in the lower elevations in order to take advantage of mountain mahogany, chokecherry, currant, nahavita, and all the Rocky Mountain plants that have adapted to cold winters, short summers, and high elevations. They traveled east onto the plains in order to hunt buffalo and traded for foods with their Pueblo neighbors to the southwest. Coyote and other tricksters. In several plant entries in this book, trickster figures play a role in how Native peoples relate to plants. Trickster stories are most often equated with coyote, but coyote is only one of many such figures among indigenous peoples. The trickster might be raven or rabbit. To my people, the Rarámuri, skunk is often a trickster. No matter the image, the concept of trickster is reflective of an American Indian consciousness or mindset that embraces the gray and uncertain personality of the natural world. These parts of our universe are often not completely knowable and are, therefore, often considered sacred. Trickster occupies that gray, uncertain, sacred space. The trickster brings to life the playful, disruptive, and creative side of human imagination. Recreating is a process that Native peoples look forward to over an annual cycle. Every ceremony, ritual, dance, healing, and initiation is an opportunity to participate in the ongoing creation of the universe and our relationship to it. From disturbance emerges new birth and diversity. We should not fear that which is different or new. Through trickster, we learn to embrace non-polarity. Color blindness is assumed, as well as every variation of gender. Therefore, trickster expands the indigenous consciousness by freeing all constraints and creating an opening and threshold for flexibility and change. Through this kind of consciousness, culture and society are in a better frame for resilient thinking and adaptation. Blending the old ways with the new, then, is a virtue and a strength that is evident in American Indian cultures. Southwest. The Hopi have occupied stone and adobe villages atop three arid mesas on the Colorado Plateau for more than a millennia. They believe Spider Woman led them up through a hole in the ground and into this world, the fourth world, in order to act as caretakers of the earth. The previous three worlds were idyllic. The first world was destroyed by fire after the people became too corrupt and forgot to take care of the land. The second world was destroyed by ice for the same reason. In the third world, the people built great cities and developed weapons that could kill their enemies from great distances. But again, they did not care for the land, and their world was destroyed by floods. This was when Spider Woman led those who still remembered their caretaker duties into this, the fourth world. The Navajo have a similar origin story, but believe that we are residing in a fifth world. The Tewa, who live along the Rio Grande River, north of Santa Fe, believe that they originated at the bottom of a shallow lake in southern Colorado. After their emergence, they migrated to where they now are. No matter the story, Native peoples of the Southwest, including the Southern Basin and Range, feel that they were led to their current homelands for a specific reason: to care for the land and to act as models of how to live properly with it. For thousands of years, they have fulfilled this charge. Of all Native peoples in the contiguous United States, the peoples of these arid regions have remained most admirably resilient, adhering to their lands, their languages, their spirituality, their food ways, and their plant knowledge. The Southwest is a land of extreme contrast, host to an incredible array of biocultural diversity. These words may sound like a cliched travel brochure, but they express an absolute truth. Heading south, it is possible to drive in one day from the pine forests and upper sagebrush landscape near Durango, Colorado, through the dry red Colorado Plateau chaparral, through some more pine forest near Cayma, New Mexico, to the cacti and yucca of the Chihuahuan Desert near the Mexico-U.S. border. Alternatively, beginning again near Durango, but heading in a more southwesterly direction, it's possible to pass through the arid plateau just south of Monument Valley and make a left near the pine-forested region around Flagstaff, Arizona, to wind up in one of the most biologically diverse regions in the world, the Sonoran Desert. In any direction, you would drive over the ancestral and current homelands of indigenous communities representing 5 to 9 separate linguistic and cultural groups. Up on the Colorado Plateau, The Hopi continue to practice the Hopi way, a spiritual lifestyle that does not strive for a specific outcome or product, but rather is a journey, focused on what is learned along the way about their relationship to place and community. It is a way of resilient persistence. The Hopi have been able to successfully endure shocks to their social and environmental systems. The same can be said of most of the Pueblo peoples. Not only the Tewa, but also the Akoma, Zia, and Taos originated in other places, but in response to environmental changes, migrated and adapted to a new situation. The Apache came from parts far north, but after continued and sometimes violent movement, ended up in the southwest and adopted a nomadic lifestyle. Even Hispano peoples who eventually became indigenous to the southwest mixed traditions that they brought with them from Europe with those of their indigenous neighbors, creating the acequia system of sustainable agricultural practice, for example, which has created new highways of ethnobotanical diversity and a source of useful plants for the people. All these examples are located in specific landscapes across the Southwest. Each location is an example of cultural and ethnobotanical refugia and resilient culture and practice. Each multi-generational community maintains a deep sense of connection to the arid landscapes, which reaffirms long-term memory loops concerning traditional land management and identity. Pacific Northwest. Lewis and Clark's Corps of Discovery stumbled into the Pacific Northwest in 1805. They had already survived a harsh winter, a difficult crossing of the Continental Divide, dysentery, and a descent of the Columbia River. When they finally arrived at the coast, they were faced with unending rain, seemingly impenetrable forests with trees taller than any they had ever seen, and native peoples who were extremely comfortable in this landscape and who were indifferent to the newcomers. The Pacific Northwest is a lush landscape populated by a similar abundance of peoples. There are the Tlingit, Haida, Tsimshian, Kwakutl, and Bellakula, the Nuchanul, Quileute, Coast Salish, and Chinook. A little south along the coast of what is now Oregon live the Tillamook, Siuslaw, Umpqua, Yurok, and Hoopa. These people spoke diverse languages from the Salishan, Wakashan, Chimaquan, Penutian, and Athabascan linguistic families, but they live similar lifestyles. They took full advantage of a temperate climate. The Pacific Ocean current, although it did carry lots of moisture, also encouraged 7 kinds of salmon that spawned in the many rivers. Dense, coniferous forests supported large mammals and a variety of useful food and medicinal plants. The current landscape and forests are not that different from what they were in 1805. Unfortunately, overfishing and dams have reduced wild salmon populations, and clear cutting and mismanagement have negatively affected plant and animal life. However, Pacific Northwest peoples persist. A number of years ago, while traveling along the shores of Puget Sound, I stopped at a Skokomish community for a rest. I struck up a conversation with a young man, one of a group of several young Skokomish, who had had to convince their elders to teach them how to build large ocean-going canoes so that they could participate in the traditional canoe races held by other native communities. These canoes were central to the traditional livelihoods and cultures of the Skokomish and other coastal natives. What the young people had not counted on was that the process of building a canoe would lead to a resurgence of their language and relationship to home landscape. Canoe building is more than gathering materials and putting them together properly so that it all results in a vessel that floats. The young Skokomish were first taught the proper cedar trees to harvest, how to harvest them with respect and ritual, when to harvest, and which songs to sing in the process. They had to perform these rituals in their native language. They were told stories that related to canoes and cedar trees. They learned about the ecosystems that the canoes were harvested from and how they, the young canoe builders, were directly related to it. The young man told me that when they began the process of learning how to build a canoe, their language was almost gone, and the people no longer felt a strong indigenous identity. By the time I met him, their language was resurgent, rituals and ceremony were again being performed, and they were involved in sustainably managing their local ecosystem. West Coast. Before the arrival of Europeans, the West Coast from British Columbia south into Baja California was the most diverse cultural area in North America. It is estimated that more than a third of all native peoples of North America lived here, in yet another region of abundance. Visitors still flock to the coast and sierras to marvel at the giant sequoias and redwoods. The arid regions and deserts that lie in the shadows of the Sierra Nevada are home to unusual and frequently endemic plant life. The Central Valley of California is often referred to as America's breadbasket. But before the arrival of European agriculture, native peoples of the West Coast were unfamiliar with this concept. They had not had to assume a sedentary agricultural lifestyle in order to secure their sources of plant foods. The numerous species of oaks provided a seasonal crop of acorns, which was supplemented throughout the year by other nut and fruit trees, tubers, kinopods, berries, and herbaceous plants. Rivers and streams teemed with fish, and there was plenty of game for the people to hunt. A commonality of this region is that the lands and waters were created by hero beings that battled monsters and other creatures on behalf of the people. Often, it is coyote who either intentionally or clumsily played a role in forming the lands of the West Coast. And not only that, the Miwok believe that coyote played a direct role in bringing people into existence and forming how human beings look today. The Yokuts believe that coyote was helped by eagle when the first humans were formed from clay. The Salinan think that eagle made first man from clay and then created first woman from one of its feathers. Over 100 distinct languages, separated into more than 300 dialects, were spoken across this landscape. The languages were derived from several linguistic families, including the Yukian, Maiduan, and Uto-Aztecan groups. Esalen and Karak are linguistic isolates, with no connection to any other language group. Each language of this region represents a culture with its own worldview and library of ecological knowledge. But all native peoples of the West Coast engaged in some form of complex and sophisticated gardening of their homelands, whether grassland, mixed woodland, wetland, chaparral, or conifer forest. Their systems of land management, seasonal pruning, coppicing, and low-intensity fire regimes not only ensured they had what they needed in terms of food, medicinal, and utilitarian plant materials, but also encouraged plant and animal diversity. These repeated cycles of clearing, fire, and careful use on a scale unimaginable today may be considered a form of advanced permaculture. Respectful harvesting. A worldview based on Iwigara compels me to act as a responsible steward of my plant relatives. It reminds me also to always give thanks to the plants when I am gathering and collecting. I will make an offering and verbally offer my gratitude to the plants being collected, as well as to the land. I am also careful to never overharvest and to spread my harvesting among several plants and locations. I am not suggesting a specific method for your own collecting. I am merely suggesting that you keep these thoughts in mind if you choose to wildcraft plants that are highlighted in this book. Much of the pre-Columbian landscape of the West Coast has been transformed over the last 500 years. But if one knows where to search and what to look for, most of the native plants can still be found. In addition, despite the near genocide of the native communities of this region, many indigenous peoples have persevered and remain resilient on their ancestral landscapes. The plants. Ash. Fraxinus spp. Family. Oleaceae. Parts used. Twigs. Bark. Wood. Season. Year-round. Region. Northeast. Choose the right tool for the job, the old maxim has it. Similar thinking can be applied to selecting woods for harvesting and carving into specific objects. Every type of wood has its own characteristics, advantages, and disadvantages. Sometimes wood offers a seemingly unlimited variety of uses. Ash is such a one. Ash trees offer a versatility of purposes to American Indians not found in many other plants. Uses. I have been told several times that tools and other implements constructed of ash seem to have a spirit or to be alive. I cannot fully explain why others would sense this about ash, but I can speak from my own experience of it as a woodworker. When ash wood has been properly seasoned and milled, its grains seem to let the woodworker know which way and in what manner to carve, cut, or plane it. When completed, tools made of ash are lightweight yet durable, able to withstand abrasions and knocks with little wear and tear, and they are flexible when they need to be. The wood is also strikingly colored, a shade of yellow infused with turmeric and saffron, and the exposed grains and knots of the wood add visual interest. For millennia, ash has been made into canoe paddles. They remain tough, even when water-soaked, and can take being knocked around by rocky river bottoms and shorelines. Ash can also be steamed and bent into snowshoes and frames for cradle boards, or heated and split into small, thin splints for making baskets of varying sizes. Ash has been made into durable lances, as well as the straightest arrows and solid bows. Birch bark canoes are framed by split and bent ash. As these and many more examples suggest, ash has been a preferred wood for native peoples. However, other parts of the tree are also put to good use. The inner bark of ash trees has many medicinal uses. That of green ash, Fraxinus pennsylvanica, can be scraped and made into an infusion for fatigue and depression, or be used as a diuretic and a laxative against worms. It can also be chewed and applied to skin sores. The inner bark of white ash, Fraxinus americana, has been used to help stimulate menses and as a liver and gastrointestinal tonic. The twigs and inner bark of Oregon ash, Fraxinus latifolia, are used to reduce fevers and as a snake repellent. Other species of ash offer similar medicinal uses. Identification and harvest. If you were to ask the average person to name an iconic tree, you would receive all sorts of answers, depending on where the person lives or grew up. A Navajo in northern Arizona will respond differently from a Nipmuc in Connecticut. Most of the time, my students respond with pine, maple, or oak. Interestingly, I have never had a single person name the ash. Yet, ash trees are ubiquitous throughout North America. About 20 species and subspecies of ash have been identified throughout the continent. This number does not include those introduced from Europe, Africa, and Asia. Ash trees grow 30 to 60 feet tall. They are deciduous, except for a couple of species that grow in more tropical regions. The leaves are elongated oval, with fine teeth at the edges. They are opposite and pinnately compound, with leaflets in as many as 9 pairs. The lower sides of the leaves tend to be lighter than the upper sides. In early spring, a cluster of very small purplish, sometimes greenish-white flowers sprout at the tips of the leaf areas near the ends of the branches. Fruits, only on female trees, are elongated, greenish, and winged, about 2 inches long. They begin to drop from the trees in late summer, slowly spinning their way to the ground like little helicopters. In the fall, the leaves turn a rusty yellowish orange. Bark is thick and grayish. During a tree's early years, it is relatively smooth, but begins to develop fissures throughout the trunk that deepen with age. Most native peoples recognize that useful woods of deciduous trees are best collected from late winter to early spring, just as the earth is beginning to push its life-sustaining saps back up through the roots and into the trunk and branches. If the wood is collected in the dead of winter, it will not be very useful because some of the moisture in the wood is still present and frozen. As the wood thaws, the moisture exits the wood, leading to brittleness. If it is collected later in spring through fall, the wood still holds too much sap and moisture. Wood harvested at this time shrinks as it dries and tends to crack and splinter easily. Collect wood in late winter or early spring, when the sap moisture to wood ratio is just right. The wood will be strong, resilient, flexible, essential characteristics given ash's various traditional uses. Health benefits. Fraxinus species contain sicoridoids, phenylethanoids, flavonoids, coumarin, and lignans. These beneficial phytochemicals are anti-cancer, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, antimicrobial, and neuroprotective, among other pharmacotherapeutic effects. Beans. Phacealis, SPP. Family, Fabaceae. Parts used, fruit. Season, summer, fall. Region, North America. Nearly every indigenous language in the Western Hemisphere has a word for beans, which is a reflection of the ubiquity of Phacealis species in the Americas. Beans are second only to corn as the most consumed traditional food among American Indians. February gets cold on the high Colorado Plateau of northern Arizona. Hopi communities are situated here, across three mesas. For the Hopi, February is the time of Pauamuya, when the annual Pauamu, or bean dances, are celebrated. It is also the time on the Hopi ceremonial calendar when the Katsanam, or rain and earth spirits, return to the Hopi mesas in order to help the people prepare for the coming growing season and to oversee the initiation of young Hopi into a Kiva society. Kivas are subterranean structures where the different spiritual societies hold meetings and perform ceremonies. The Pauamu ceremonies are actually several rituals spread over 16 days. The rituals honor the actions of fertility as well as germination. During Pauamu, beans are sprouted inside different kivas. The sprouting beans honor the coming growing season and are seen as a good omen for the success of the harvest. On the final day of the ceremonies, many Katsanam gather and give away gifts to those in attendance. The gifts include lightning sticks, dancing sticks, arrows, rattles, moccasins, katsina dolls, and sprouted beans. My people, the Rarámuri, call beans muniki. Among the Yaqui, the word is muni, for the Hopi, mun. The similarity in nomenclature is because the three languages represent branches of the Uto-Aztecan linguistic family tree. The Lakota refer to beans as Ominicha, the Cherokee, Thuya. Uses. I cook up a pot of beans nearly every week. Normally, I cook pinto beans, but sometimes it's big, beefy, sweet runner beans or small, earthy-tasting, tepary beans, or perhaps some yellow beans. Maybe I will do the pinto-like beans white with splotches of black and brown that resemble little black and white goats. The choices are many, and they all taste good. Across Native North America, dried beans are cooked and eaten plain or with different spices and additional ingredients. They are main characters in soups and stews. They are cooked and mashed to make a soup base. The Cherokee will mash cooked beans and make them into bread or just add them to hickory nut soup. Many tribes enjoy cooking beans with fresh and dried corn. It is likely that the original Thanksgiving feast included deer, waterfowl, turkeys, shellfish, eels, squash, corn, and beans. Many American dishes that are cooked and eaten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.